KPRT K291 Kansas City. Gospel 1590 106.1 FM.
It's 9 o'clock a.m. Welcome to the Morning Glory Show. Turn your volume up and let the word of God pierce your soul. 1590 AM on your radio dial and 106.1 on your FM, pal.
Thank you for tuning in to the Morning Glory radio broadcast with Drs. Adam and Adrian Blackstock of Glory Bible Fellowship International Church. Sit back and get ready to receive a word that will transform your life.
Good morning, radio family in the greater Kansas City area. Today is a very special broadcast. I have with me dear friend in the gospel, Rabbi Shamuel Wolfenfield. And so go ahead, text it out, let everybody know he's here. There's a powerful event that he's going to share with us that is taking place to support Israel here in our local Kansas City area. So I want you to get as many people as possible on social media to share this. Amen. And we're not just going to speak about that. I want him to be able to speak about whatever it is the Lord has laid upon his heart. Amen. Because many of us need to understand the connection of our Jewish heritage as relates to Yeshua. Amen. So please join us to tomorrow night in Bible study at 7 p.m. This month of Thanksgiving and time of celebration. We're just thankful. We're calling it a month of Thanksgiving and testimonies. Amen. And then on Sunday mornings, our fellowship breakfast starts at 10:15 and the worship service starts at 10:30. We're in this month of the shift. Amen. So please join us. Go to connect with us on Facebook, go to YouTube, all those other places. I want to get right into getting Rabbi to go ahead and introduce himself formally and the church that he's at, and tell us also what is taking place today. And then I'm going to pick your brain if anything else come up in my spirit for us to be able to discuss.
Thank you, Prophetess Adrienne. And you and Adam have been dear friends for maybe 15, 20 years now. And it's just been a joy to get to know you guys and preach at your church once or twice and be on your program. And so I'm the rabbi of the Or HaOlam Messianic Congregation. You can see a virtual of my synagogue in the background there. And the way virtual backgrounds go, the back of my chair is flashing in and out, but it's really still there. So don't let that confuse you.
It's beautiful.
Thank you. And by the way, we'd love for you to visit anytime you want, Saturday morning, 10 o'clock. And the back wall that you see, when COVID struck and the governor told us to shut down, and we believed it for a while, we went down to 10 people and we went from having a congregational building to a broadcast studio. Somebody who has had broadcast expertise told us that our back wall was too dark. And so we thought about painting it, but we also thought, you know, there's a business in town called Jerusalem Stone. It's run by an Israeli family, the Nachums. Ben Nachum is the current manager, and they take scrap building stones from Jerusalem because the city ordinance is that they have to have a certain percentage, 60 or 70% of the building front there has to be the ancient colored stone that the wall and the temple and all is made out of, that beautiful golden pinkish stone. That's why Jerusalem is called the city of gold. One of the reasons is because of that stone. So that is genuine Jerusalem stone that we bought from Ben Nachum, and we had it installed as the front of our sanctuary. And when the stonemason put it up, he didn't put any mortar between the tiles. So there's room for prayer requests between the cracks of the stone. We have some prayer requests there.
You make me come over on a Saturday morning. Amen. I'm telling you, it is such a, when you go, and our son who's that's gone to be with the Lord, he was the child that would love to go over when Bishop and I would come over on a Saturday if I came over on a Saturday. And so AJ, so he always enjoyed coming over with us when we came over on a Saturday. So Rabbi, I want you to tell us what's going on today and how can we be support by going out, and also those that can't go, how to stand in prayer as well, and maybe enlighten us on maybe any information you have in reference to what's going on in Jerusalem.
Sure. Well, I'm a Jewish boy from New York City, grew up in a very secular Jewish home, And the short story is, I came to faith in 1969. If you saw the movie Jesus Revolution, that was me. I was a hippie wannabe, not in California, but in New York State, but just the drugs and all that stuff. And so God just rescued me, turned my life around. I've been walking with the joy of the Lord since then. And we're just glad to be with him. And of course, I grew up with stories of the Holocaust and the formation of the State of Israel. And I thought, well, that's terrible stuff that happened way back then. And we've always had a sense that, well, anti-Semitism is possible. But we thought, oh, that's kind of fantasy, fiction. It'll never really happen until right at the end of days. But it's happening right now. The hatred for Jewish people is unbelievable. It's just reared up. Actually, in the 1990s, there was a time when there's an organization in Toronto, Canada, the Jewish Defense, not Jewish Defense League, the can't remember the name is, but they thought of disbanding because anti-Semitism, you know, seemed to be a thing of the past, but they're back in business now. And so the Anti-Defamation League, I guess it's called. And so what happened on October 7th was just, it wasn't warfare. The Hamas soldiers that came over weren't looking to conquer territory. They were just looking to kill and to mutilate. And I don't have to go into all the stories, but 1,400 deaths. But these weren't just military deaths. These were civilians and women and children that died in horrible, torturous ways. So the Israelis had thought that, okay, Hamas is contained. We've got a fence. We've got even an underground wall. We've got sea barriers. They thought they had Hamas under control. They thought they were making peace with the Saudis, and that's good. And, you know, the Abraham Accords. And they thought, President Biden said about 2 months ago, that there's a new era of peace coming. But the Hamas were preparing with the help of, first of all, Satan, and second of all, the help of the Iranians.
Come on, get back.
Yes. A whole level of sophistication that overwhelmed the Israeli defenses and security. And so for 8 or 9 hours, the Hamas murdered and killed and plundered and raped, and maybe not plundered, they didn't really take much, but raped and destroyed and tortured. Awful death. There's a death so bad, or a fire so bad in one of the homes, that they actually had to call in an archaeologist who specializes in ruined cities, bone fragments, because there was so much devastating destruction. So the Israelis have decided that they can't just live with Hamas's neighbors. It's not tenable. They can't have that. There was no way to fence them in adequately. So they are fighting a war to destroy this enemy. And it's not their choice to have this war, but it's absolutely a necessity. So a little to our amazement, within hours after the attack, before the Israelis had even started the counterattack, there have been worldwide protests against the Jews. Like, Hamas was right to go in and do all this destruction and to do all this devastation worldwide. Protests, even in America, on the college campuses, the schools that I went to. I'm an East Coast guy. I didn't go to Ivy League. I wasn't quite that smart, but I went to semi-Ivy League school, Union College was called. But there's protests on the Ivy League colleges and Columbia. I did go to Columbia for some summer classes as a high school, but Columbia and Harvard and all UP, all the prestigious schools that have big Jewish populations, especially in my day with big Jewish populations, they're very virulently protesting against Israel. So what we feel we need to do, one of our young women actually proposed it, and I thought first she proposed it like Thursday of last week, and I said, oh, that's just too big a project to put together. Well, it turned out it wasn't that big of a project to put together. One of our guys is experienced in getting permits because we've done outreach. And so he arranged the permit. So we are going to be at noon at the what used to be called the J.C. Nichols. Now it's just called the Plaza Fountain on 47th Street there, next, just to the east a little bit of Crown Center. No, of Country Club Plaza. And beautiful area there. And we'll be there doing a peaceful demonstration, a peaceful, there'll be songs, there'll be dance. It won't be an evangelistic event because I've given out handbills at the Jewish Community Center, and I've told people the Jewish Community Center, this is not religious. It's not about Yeshua, Jesus. It's just about supporting Israel and the prophetic. Thank you. The prophetic destiny God called. If you read the Bible, you read particularly Ezekiel 37, the dry bones. The dry bones is, it, you can say it's about church revival, but it's primarily about the restoration of the dry bones, the people of Israel. And there's one line in the middle of that chapter that says, our hope is lost. And so that line, Od lo adva tikvatenu, our hope is not lost, that line is incorporated into the national anthem, the Hatikva. And the name of the song is the Hatikva, our hope is not lost. So God restored the dry bones after hatred of the Jews. I mean, there's been the persecutions in history, the Inquisition in Spain and the pogroms in Eastern Europe and the Crusades in medieval times in the 1000s or so, destroying Israel, destroying the Jews. But this one, Hamas, is right in the backyard of Israel. Israel was meant to be a place where Jews could be safe, and they weren't safe. They didn't build their defenses well enough. So we're just going to go there and stand. And we don't know what opposition we're going to have. So we're praying and fasting today, yes, actually, because this is a spiritual warfare. This is a spiritual dynamic. And over the weekend, I heard 300,000 people were taking the cause of Hamas, taking the cause of these murderers in London. Besides the protests that I just mentioned, just recently in London, England. England is the place where there was a revival of Christianity and the Zionist movement got a great boost, the Balfour Declaration. Britain is the nation that helped the Jews return. They also hindered the Jews returning. It's a little bit of a complicated history, turned against them during World War II, did not let the Holocaust escapees go into what the British called Palestine. By the way, a little side note, but it's very important for your listeners to know, Palestine is not actually a geographical reality. That is.
Please say that again.
Okay. Palestine is the name that the Romans gave after they defeated and destroyed Israel. They decided to name the place after the Philistines, after the long since disappeared ethnic group, the Philistines, which was where Goliath came from, the enemies of Israel. It was just a name of mockery that they gave to Israel, Judea, Samaria, the places of Israel. They called it Palestine. Palestine has never had a national identity, never had a government, never had a capital. There's never been a capital in Jerusalem of Palestine. There really are no people. As a matter of fact, Yasser Arafat, the most famous Palestinian leader, was born in Alexandria, Egypt. He's an Egyptian. And when the Jews, if you read Mark Twain's book, Pilgrim's Progress, it was called, I'll think of the name, but Mark Twain's book about his journey, Innocents Abroad, that was called, his journey through Israel at that time, it was ruled by the Turks. It was so desolate. There was almost zero population, no trees. The Turks had a wonderful policy that they taxed you according to how many trees were on your property. So the Arabs, who didn't care about the land, cut down all the trees. So if the land was desolate before, when the Turks ruled it, it became really desolate, lost all its trees. And when Mark Twain was there, he says, there isn't even wagon trails. There's nothing here. You could go for miles and not see anybody, just some Bedouin camps here and there, but really spread out. And the Bedouins didn't have any particular loyalty to territory. They were travelers. They were nomads by design. That was their culture. And so when the Jews started to return and love the land and made things grow that nobody said could grow, they planted vineyards in places that had been vineyards in ancient times that the scientists said, the agricultural scientists said, you can't grow grapes here. This soil is not good for grapes. But there was an Israeli guy that believed the Bible and planted a vineyard, and now it's an award-winning vineyard. Pisgot, I think it's called, vineyards, and they're a miracle. And a lot of Christians come over and actually help them in the vineyards. And so they redeemed the land. They rebuilt the land because they loved the land, because God's word said, and some of these were not such Bible believers, certainly not believers in Yeshua, in Jesus, but they believed the word of God in at least enough to rebuild the land. And so Arabs moved in. There was a huge Arab influx of people because they needed workers, they needed helpers, they needed support. And so they hired a lot of Arab workers. And sad to say, until October 7th, as of October 6th, I'm pretty sure the number is between 20 and 30,000 Gazans would come into Israel and work. And the Jews thought, we've given them prosperity, we've given them labor, we've given them better wages than they can have in Gaza, because the Hamas take all the money, or at least 90%, a huge percentage of the money, the aid money that's given to them, and they use it to build tunnels and rockets and terrible infrastructure, murderous infrastructure. They don't help their own people. The hospital that's right now the center of all this warfare was built when the Israelis administered Gaza from 1967 till 2005. The Israelis, before that, the Egyptians had it. Then the Israelis just pulled out, but they built that hospital. That's an Israeli-built hospital because the Israelis tried to administer it rightly. But I'm saying there was no Palestinian identity. What's now, the people that call themselves Palestine immigrated because of Jewish prosperity. And under the Turks and under the British, they really didn't have an ethnic identity. Even to the time of the restoration of Israel, they called themselves Syrians. They called Greater Syria is one of the terms they like to use for that land area. So the war that they're fighting, let Palestine be free. Palestine, in terms of Gaza, there's no Jews in Gaza. Ariel Sharon, in 2005, pulled all the Jewish settlements out of there. As I mentioned, from 67 war till 2005, there were Jewish settlements there. They were purchased land. They weren't stolen land, but Ariel Sharon removed everybody there. So Hamas had complete control over Gaza. No, zero Jews there. Hitler called that Judenrein, Jew free. No Jews. They could build it whatever they wanted, but they decided they had to mount this murderous attack, and all the world seemingly has sympathized with them. Well, we are going to stand, and we don't know what kind of opposition, we don't know what kind of counter protest, we don't know what kind of possible violence there will be. The Kansas City police has been notified that we're having this demonstration, but it's going to be a peaceful demonstration. We're going to sing, we're going to pray, we're going to talk about God's destiny for the Jews to return to the land, build up the land, celebrate in the land, rejoice in the land, build their families. Those Gazan communities, I mean, they're called, it's called the Gaza Ring, the Gaza Circle, the Jewish circle settlements, the Jewish, they're brilliant settlements. These are Jewish towns that were on the perimeter of Gaza. Beautiful, peaceful, family-oriented, mostly secular. They weren't religious communities, but they were wonderful family-oriented settlements. October 6th, the towns looked like paradise. October 7th, they looked like hell. They looked like, well, they were a war zone, a war depredation. So we're just going to stand and say, Israel, we love you. We bless you. My parents sent me to Israel in 1971. I became a believer in Messiah in 69, and they offered me, I figured, well, if I go to Israel and see the beauty of the land and the spirit of the people and the spirit, it'll turn him back. Well, it didn't actually turn me back. It just encouraged me. Wow, God is doing something spectacular. Built me up in my faith. And so I felt like I need to make my life here, but I'm not quite ready. And so then this happened and that happened and life happened. And now I'm 74. So now I'm ready.
You do not look like you're 74. A rabbi. I want you guys to hear what he said. It's a peaceful rally, but one of the things that the rabbi was saying, and many people, it is a spiritual battle. So those indeed of you that you're listening, you may be at work, those of you, we do have intercessors that are going to be praying at GBFIC during that 12 at starting at 12 o'clock And then there are those of us, I will be there. Some of our intercessors are coming. So those of you, it is our responsibility to stand. If you say that you are a Christian, the Bible does not lie. Amen. So this is a spiritual battle. The person behind it is Satan, right? And these are, and so we have to understand that and know that about spiritual warfare in this regards. And so we're going to go there peacefully. We're going to be pleading the blood of Jesus. We're going to be pleading the blood of Jesus. We're asking God to bless Israel. Now, Rabbi, I think we got about 2 minutes. And one of the reasons when I texted you and you was able to remind, you was able to say, hey, did you get my email? This scripture, which is in, and I have to have it in my Bible and read it from the Easy Version. And the early days, for those who know, Bishop is Jewish born, and that's how we, you know, got connected or what have you. But this scripture I've had to give to so many Christians, like run over it. And it is in Romans 11:11-12. I want you to see if you can say something about this. It says, so now I ask this, when Israel's people failed to accept Jesus as God's Messiah, did they make themselves separate from God forever? No, certainly that is not true. Because of their mistake, God is now saving Gentiles. That's us, that's not Jewish born. God is doing that so that Israel's people will become jealous because of their mistake. God has done good things for everyone in the world. Israel's people failed to receive what God wanted to give them. As a result, the Gentiles have received very many good things from God. That was the good result when Israel people failed. So when the complete number of Israel people do return to God, the result will even be better. And so this scripture has always, when I'm dealing with Christians, to understand that we were grafted in and how it is our job as Christians to be able to still stand and pray for our Jewish brothers and sisters.
Yeah, that's right. So this messianic revival that you see me sitting in front of this congregation is not just for us. Scripture teaches that when the Jews come back to faith in the Messiah, in the King, it'll be a spillover. It'll be a greater revival to the Gentiles, to the whole world, greater even than the first century revival that transformed the Roman Empire. It's going to be in a time of war, in a time of a lot of destruction, we know, but nevertheless, a lot of Gentile people will be saved. Now, let me put in this a bit of caution. This meeting on the 12th, or at 12 noon, that is today, will not be about Jesus or Yeshua or Messiah. I've advertised it in the Jewish community that it's just pro-Israel. So it's not evangelistic. It's not about Messiah. It's just about God and Israel. And people ask us questions. Of course, we're not going to hide our faith and deny our faith, but we're not there to promote Yeshua. Not at this time. This is to lay a seed, a groundwork that we are supporting God's movement and the right of the people of Israel to exist in their own land, in their own sovereign nation that God gave it to them. And as we do that, as Jews understand the return of the Jewish people to Israel and concomitant to that, in 1967, when the Jews won the Six-Day War, as they call it, there was a great breakthrough in the spirit. And that's when I got saved. That's when that whole Jesus Revolution movement took place. So we are delighted to anticipate that in this terrible time of war, there will be a victory. There will be a victory that will precipitate a spiritual victory, a spiritual breakthrough, just like in 67, because the whole Jesus movement, the whole Yeshua movement, we like to call it, people getting saved across the messianic movement. If you go to Messiah Conference, a lot of people my vintage that came to faith out of the victory. We're trusting God for a big victory, but there's a lot of opposition. And it does say in Zechariah, all nations are going to come against Israel. And right now it looks like that's going to happen. But we'd rather say, Lord, let that be a later war. Let's win this war. Let's have shalom.
Amen. We have 2 minutes left, Rabbi. Maybe give 3 points for those who, they could be praying behind the scene, those that are not going to be there. That they can pray for during this time.
Well, one is just for safety, that there's no counter protest that would be murderous. There was a story in San Diego, I think, where
I've seen that.
And they hit a guy over the head with a megaphone. He fell to the ground and had a concussion from falling to the ground and died out of that. Well, we don't want any violence. That's one of the things. But that's not really the biggest thing. The biggest thing is we want the community, the city of Kansas City, to understand that God loves the Jewish people. God loves all people, but he's got a calling on the Jewish people, and they have a covenantal right to the land of Israel. They want to build it in peace, buy the land legitimately, which they have done over the years, over the generations, and live in peace with their neighbors. That's the calling, and that the murderous spirit is of the darkness, of the dark side, as they call it, of the Hasatan, of the devil that looks to destroy Israel. The spirit of Hitler, the spirit of the Inquisition, the spirit of the pogroms, the spirit of Jew hatred is alive. It's alive, and it's demonic, and it's destructive, and we are standing for truth. The Hebrew term is Am Yisrael Chai. The people of Israel live. We'll be singing that song, Am Yisrael Chai, Od Avinu, yet our Father in heaven lives, and we're trusting that God will bless. It's really this whole message or this whole rally is about the blessing. God says, I will bless those that bless you. We're inviting the whole city, the Gentile and Jewish world, to bless Israel. It's all about blessing and joy and redemption and shalom, peace.
Amen. And Jesus is Lord. Thank you, Rabbi.
Hallelujah.
This program has been a blessing to you. Feel free to partner with us by sowing a seed at gbfic.org or mailing a check to Morning Glory at 1126 Northeast Delta School Road in Lee Summit, Missouri, 64064. If you need special prayer of any kind, please feel free to call us at 816-795-1900.
Quality child care makes a difference, especially